It's a privilege to share with you as the part two, and we're doing three parts on knowing God. So don't worry if you were not here last week, but we're gonna jump straight into it as to the last scripture that we ended off, and it's a scripture that Paul wrote to the Philippian church, the church in Philippi. Paul is under great stress, and he's done a lot of things. He's seen a lot of stuff happen in his life. He's come to many conclusions. You know, it's easy sometimes, and especially there are lots of young people here, students, and you're very passionate, and that is great. You know, if you're older here, please surround yourself with young people, because the zeal of the Lord and the passion, and that is great. We should never lose that. You know, love what Reinhard Bunker says. He says, dignity is not a fruit of the Spirit. You know, sometimes we think we must become more reserved the more we know God. But there's actually this heart of David that God is restoring, this place where we have a freedom, and a freedom to worship Him, to express Him in the way that you not just feel comfortable, but sometimes that He will find acceptable. And sometimes we just ask God and say, God, how do you want me to worship you? And so the theme is sort of knowing God. It's actually a very difficult subject. Because I must acknowledge that there is no way we can try to pursue God in an intellectual pursuit. When we know God, we must come with our hearts. We must come. And there is an intellectual worship. There is a worship with our bodies. But there's a revelation knowledge that we need. Like when Jesus asked Peter and he said, Peter, do you also want to go away? Because lots of the disciples started to walk away from Christ. And then he says, Lord, where are we going to go? We have nowhere to go because you have the words of eternal life. At a later stage, Jesus asks, who do you say that I am? And he says, but you are the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. And then Jesus says, well, what flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And he says, on this revelation knowledge, I will build my church and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom. And so when we go to Paul's writing here in Philippians chapter 3, verse 7, I'm going to read slowly through it. Are you all awake this morning? Okay, are you actually excited to be in the house of God? Amen. So I'm very excited. So lock the doors. We're in Africa, so we're going to have a long... No. Verse 7. But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I might gain Christ. Verse 9, and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. And then this is His cry, His prayer, says that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection, and the fellowship of His sufferings, being conformed to His death. If by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead, not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I might lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, that's not us, I do not count myself to have apprehended or have to have arrived. But one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. It is a loaded scripture, would you agree? it is very deep if you can hear the heart of Paul crying out. And this is a learned of the learned Pharisees. He's got all the degrees. He's got the theology going. He's been around. He's been everywhere. He's seen a lot of stuff, big stuff. He's seen small stuff. He's been everywhere. And he had a lot. And sometimes he had a lot. Been almost killed. And he got killed later on. And then the Bible says he just stood up when the disciples came around him and then started walking again. I want us to start here in verse 7. It says, he made a sum. He sort of made a calculation. And he says it twice in the scripture. He says that I've went to count. Now, when you go to count, We have like this little spa blikkie, you know. I don't know if you still have spa blikkies at home, you know. It's like a spare blike, you know, in English. It's like, no, you get your money in there, and then you throw all your small change in there, and then sort of some other time you go out, and then you get the kids or whatever, and you throw out all the 2 rand and the 5 rands, and then you pack it all together. You sort of count it out. You measure it out. And it's almost this type of picture that he draws. He says, I've come to count out my life. I've come at sort of the end of my life, but I've gained a lot of things. Spiritual things, emotional things, successful things. I've been through a lot of trouble. But I've counted all of that loss. You know, for us, and even being in Myanmar 2 weeks ago in the persecuted church, being there and realizing that people that have got nothing, but yet they have got so much joy. They found Christ. It's like they really have found the treasure of life, the pearl of greatest price. So you see these old Umis, 70 years old. Now, the Umis wear dresses. They call it lungis, you know. So we also had to wear it. We could only hold out for 2 days because I couldn't dance properly because I was just, you know, afraid that I'm going to lose my lungi some or other time, you know. Because they've perfected this thing of how you knoop it here in front, you know. So I'm just thinking like, oh my chona machantas, you know. I don't want to be like David. So the dance was always sort of like half-mast and always checking that the hands wasn't up there, because I was thinking if this thing falls off, then I can't go there. So I had to like go half-mast here, okay. So today you have got no excuse when you dance. You can go like this. But realizing this 70-year-old man of faith that has been through persecution and he's just dancing before God. That moment when he could enter into the presence of God and sort of lose focus of all the negative stuff, all the challenges out there. It's like being present with God, being in that, entering into the joy of your salvation. Because you've gone to measure out, you've gone to count out that those things are nothing. All the successes, all this stuff. Now, when we come to God with baggage, when we come to God with our luggage, when we come to God with all that stuff, Scripture says we can't. When we run the race, you must lay down every weight, every sin that so easily ensnares us, in Hebrews chapter 12. And so here Paul writes this, and he says, yet indeed, again, he says, I've counted all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ. This is verse 7. Some translations talks about the all-surpassing value of Christ, of knowing Christ. It's like it's immeasurable in human terms. It's immeasurable in trying to say, yo, I've done my day thing, I've done it today, and now I feel good about myself. When you've come to realize this salvation and the power of forgiveness, of knowing Christ, there's nothing else to that. Can I get an amen? Okay, so that's where we started last week, and he says, I've suffered loss of all these things and count them as rubbish. Now, the rubbish is almost like a swear word. It's like what we do in the toilet. That's the word. That's how harsh he says. I've counted those things not just as loss. I've counted them as cow dung. I've counted them as stuff that you must flush away. Stuff that is wasted that you can't use anymore. Everything. Now, it's not just talking about the suffering and the bad stuff and the negative stuff that has happened to him. He's talking about his successes. He's talking about everything that he can bring to the table. And he qualifies this in the next part in verse 9. He says that I may be found in him, not just know him, not just count these things, but be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ Jesus. Isn't this amazing? Righteousness. What is righteousness? It means to be in the right relationship with God, to have a right standing before God. You know, sometimes we forget that we are free. As Christians, the greatest gift that you and I have in the righteousness of God is the fact that our sins are forgiven. Isn't that amazing? You are free. I am free. I do not owe anybody any spiritual or emotional debt. I'm free. You're free. If you walk in the righteousness of Christ, if you have the righteousness of Christ, it's a gift. It's not something you can earn. It's not something because you're good and you've grown up in a Christian home, or you're a nice person, or you have a nice personality, or you do the good deeds out there. Nothing of those things qualify in the righteousness of Christ. It's that moment when you stand before Him and you have the breastplate of righteousness on that protects your heart and all the internal organs, that makes you live. That's why it's a breastplate. We put on a helmet of salvation to keep us sane from confusion and the crazy world out there, to walk in the joy of your salvation. If you lose the joy of your salvation, you are going to get crazy. You are going to get anxious. You are going to get worried. Why? Because you forget this great gift that God has given. That keeps you sane. But on this breast, we put the breastplate of righteousness. It protects you from any death. It protects you from any shame, any attacks from that hits at the major organs of your life. Is the breastplate of righteousness. And the Bible says we must put it on. We must put on Christ. I have this freedom, not because of what I've done or you've done, but because of the blood of Jesus. And we're going to partake of communion at the end of the service. And it's the greatest moment when we can come to sit together and say, God, because of your blood, because of your broken body, we can have life. This is life. You know, too many charismatic people, what we do is we're always waiting for the next breakthrough. We're always waiting for the next thing that must happen. We're always running to the next miracle. While our joy is found in Him, in the righteousness of standing before Him and not being judged by God. It's not my own righteousness, it's the gift from God. But it says, how do we attain that gift? Every day you have to put on that breastplate by faith. He says, it's not by the law, it's not by works, it's not by how disciplined I am. It's simply, I enter into that position by faith. And yet sometimes before I preach, I say, okay, Lord, I step out of Sias and I step into Christ now. Because if I give people Sias, it's going to be a mess. But if I give people Jesus, if they can see Jesus, if they can know the righteousness of Christ, and they, Holy Spirit, you're the teacher here, then people's lives are going to be transformed. Why? Because that's the greatest gift. It's the forgiveness. It's what God has come to do on the cross. He says, that righteousness we attain by faith. You know, in this town, we live in an intellectual town. We live where there's spirits of unbelief ministering to you every day, and many people don't even know it. You wake up and you're surrounded by people that don't believe, or sometimes a lecturer that walks into the class and says, this God thing, you're crazy, you know. But the amazing thing is when you and I walk in and we have this confidence in the righteousness of Christ, we are righteous. We have a right standing before God. And therefore, my identity and my authority comes from Him. I am secure in Him. And this is what Paul says, writing from prison. He says, look here, all these things that happened, maybe I'm going to die tomorrow. These guys are going to kill me. But you know what? Even in prison, do you know what I want to do? He says it here. Verse 10, he says, that I might know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being conformed to His death. You know, when we were there in Plett with lots of matrix going wild, there's at the church there, the Plett Community Church. It's a great church if you ever go to Plett. They always open up the doors for us to bring all the students there to minister to matrix. So they asked me to preach there the morning, and it was a massive privilege, and I think I told the pastor, I said, Johan, you're taking a massive risk. I swing from the chandeliers, you know, and he said, really? I said, yeah, you know, but that was just a joke. So, I remember after the service, this lady walking up to me and saying she was married for 2 years and her husband died. 6 months into the marriage, her husband died of cancer. So everybody prayed, everybody fasted, everybody was standing and had the promises of God, and yet this man died. And that was now a year later, and she came up to me. And I don't even know what I said, but there was something that struck her, that when we talked about giving those things that you don't even understand, you bring it to God so that God can redeem it, or it can make you better. And so we sat down and she started to speak about her experiences of how Christians reacted to what was happening. So everybody was standing in faith, everybody was praying, everybody was going like for it. They were laying hands and they came every day. Until her husband died. And looking at how they treated that discouragement and that disappointment, she said it was crazy. There was different groups. Some groups just didn't come to see it. They didn't know how to respond to pain or suffering. Then there were other people that were really sympathetic and had lots of empathy, and they came to mourn with her. They said, hey, we don't understand. We have prayed. We've put out our faith, but it didn't work. And then there were other people that came and said, you obviously don't have enough faith. There's obviously an open door. And they were the minority. There's obviously an open door in your life. You know, and I said to her, I'm glad those people weren't around me because I would have smacked them. You know? And so in your life, you're going to be surrounded with a lot of reactions as to stuff that happens in your life. And then you're going to be challenged to stand in the righteousness of God. And this lady started to talk on how she was ministering to other girls and how she knew that this death was not from God, but she knew that God could even use this, her greatest pain. And he showed us something of the cross, of how he went through that same pain on the cross. And that brought such deliverance to her, such freedom. And suddenly, she could have a lot of empathy and love for people around her because God started to send people to her. Now she had to make a choice. Either she's going to be bitter, either she's going to point a finger at God and say, oh God, you, why you? Or she's going to realize that God is going to make all things work together. In this, she wants to know God. In this, she wants to know the fellowship of his suffering. Now, this is not a part that we as the church like to talk about, but do you know how much Paul was in prison? Do you know how Paul and Silas sit in prison and then they worship God? So they don't worship God to open up the prison doors. They worship God, and because of their worship, the prison doors just open up. So they don't even realize that the prison doors have opened up. But why do we sometimes worship God so that he must open up the prison doors instead of knowing him for who he is? And there's some of us this morning that must bring some of that pain, some of that unanswered question, some of that stuff that you're fighting, that you're fighting with. You must bring it to God and say, God, I want you to redeem me. The fellowship of his sufferings. And then he says, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead, not that I've already attained or I'm already perfected. He says, no, I haven't arrived. I'm not mature. I don't know everything. And so we're going to, that was just part of the introduction. So I want us to, last week we started with packing your bags. I said, call it packing your bags. That's what he says. He says, leaving this stuff. And there's three things that he says about when you have to move on. There's some of you this morning that must move on from last year or from the successes. Because every day it's like God's mercies are new. Every day when you approach him, when you come, you must, there's some people that just sort of have the favor of God on their lives, and it seems like other people don't. I sometimes once struggled with God and said, God, why do you bless some people and it seems like you don't bless other people? You've got favorites. And then the Lord answered me very clearly. He said to me, you have to choose my favor. Yes, I have favorites. It's those who choose my favor. Because you and I can have a distant relationship with God, or we can have a relationship with God through somebody else. We can have a relationship through the pastor of the church, or we can have a relationship through YouTube with God. But you know what? That you're going to learn a lot of things. You're going to learn a lot about God, but it doesn't mean you know God. It doesn't mean I know God. So he says, when we start off on this journey of knowing God, we're forgetting those things that are behind. Forget them. He doesn't say, put them in a bag somewhere, hold them on. Now, let me use an example here. Say, I'm going to ask you a question. Say, for instance, you're going on a journey. Okay, so somebody phoned you and you say, that person tells you, you're going to go away for 3 months. All your clothes, all your food, and all your shelter will be provided for. So you're not going to pack any of those things. But you have 3 items that you can take with you. So in an hour, we're going to come and pick you up. You have 3 items that you can take with you. What will those 3 items be? I want you to think. I want you to talk to somebody next to you quickly. Tell them, what would those 3 items be that you would take with you? Honestly. Only 3, not 5, not 3. This must be very difficult for the ladies especially. But Now everybody is trying to figure out what will they pack. I think some of the grandmas and granddads will probably pack their grandchildren. Okay. I hope you said you will pack your wife as well. Okay, take your wife as well. Okay, but if we focus on items, you know, if we focus on items, well, let me just tell you this. Once we went on this mission trip to northern parts of India, nowhere in the Khamadulas, yeah, and then this lady, she had a whole extra case, a vanity case, with two hair dryers and everything in. I said, so when I got to the airport, I said, lady, do you know there's not even electricity? She didn't think that there's not electricity in some parts of the world, you know. And I was thinking, okay, this is going to be a fun trip for you. The mascara you have in there, India is where there's, you're going to sweat it out, girl. Yeah. She never opened the vanity case. But in any case, so. But you know, we all like to pack these items with. But you know how we do the same emotionally and spiritually? Hopefully one of those items was your Bible. Because you can live by that. But we all have these things that we sort of hang on to. But do you know how emotionally, when we go on the journey to follow Christ and to know Him, then we pack a lot of spiritual things. We pack our experiences, positive or negative. We all stuff. But Paul says, I forget. And that's why we must become like children, because children forget what happened yesterday. They want to play now. Yeah. When they wake up, you know, I remember my children, especially the one, I'm not going to mention any names, but the one would, we could not wake him up when it's school time. 7 o'clock in the morning, it's like, yeah. Saturday morning, he's awake at 6 a.m. I said, now, why do you wake up? No, he says, because then there's more time to play today, you know. But the rest of the week, we cannot wake him up because it's school, you know. But we pack these things with on our journey because, but Paul says, in this place, learn to forget. Learn to get away from the past. Don't, some of us wear scars and you're not going to forget about them, but there's certain emotional stuff that we need to let go. Then he says, not just that, in our journey, we need to reach out to the things that are ahead. There's a goal, there's certain stuff. And then he comes to the third level. He says, I don't just reach out to the purpose or the will of God. I press toward the goal for the call of God. When you press, it means you have to forcefully press through a crowd. You forcefully press something that is open. You have to press, you have to close it. So he says, I press toward the goal. I know there's going to be a resistance. I have to press through certain things. And he says that goal is the upward call of God, the prize of Christ. I have to forget certain things. There's certain things you have to forget. The last years, the 10 years ago, the when we's. Oh, when I was a Christian, when I was your age, I did that. Yes, yes, but now I must live a more balanced life. I hear that a lot. Just become more balanced. Huh? Balanced? Yes, you balance your one foot in heaven and one foot on earth, but there's no other balance. Seek first the kingdom of God in everything we do. Amen? Okay? Sometimes we use our comfort zones as an excuse not to see the kingdom of God come. It's getting very quiet. The second thing he focused on a lot is he says, I count all things as rubbish. And that means that there's an attitude by which we follow this journey to get to know God. It is called humility. And only you can only really truly see God if you have a humble heart. And humility means that there's a brokenness, there's a vulnerability, there's a transparency. There's a surrender. There's a giving up of control of certain rights, of certain stuff that I'm entitled to, certain questions that I can even ask God. I remember Nick, part of his testimony, the guy who's lost his arms and his legs, he asked God so much, why God, why God, why God, why did I get born without arms or legs? And I remember in his testimony, he said, the Lord just asked him a question, will you trust me? Will you trust me? Will you surrender those thoughts, those pains? Because lots of us say, God, I'm going to start to follow you wholeheartedly when you do this and this, when you explain a lot of things to me. But here, Paul and Silas, even in prison, they worship despite their circumstances. God wants to bring us to that place of brokenness, that vulnerability. But brokenness isn't easy because we all like to hide. We all like to pretend. We all like to keep other people and God at a distance because in that way we can control God. We can control our circumstances and we can control the outcomes. And God says, I want you to circumcise your heart. I want you to worship me wholly, fully. You know, I think I told this story, but it was so amazing when we were having holiday there at at Montague. So now you teach your children certain things, and then your children just do it, you know. So now what happened is all the Josh's nephews and nieces, they were catching fish. So what happened is they didn't, like, open up the reel. So what happened is one of the nephews' rod was taken by the fish. Big fish caught it, and it dragged the rod and everything into the water, into this big dam. Now, you know, there's absolutely no way in the natural that you're going to find that rod. So now the one nephew is crying. Everybody else is panicking. The moms are running around, and the nephew is breaking down and all of that stuff. And so Josh just walks up, and he says, now, while all of us, pastor included, you know, are thinking like, oh, how are we gonna tend to the situation and get the kids to calm down, because this is now going to be the end of the holiday, because you know how kids go, everybody's so into fishing now and all that stuff. And Josh just says, but I know God is big. Let's stand here and pray and ask him to bring out this rod. And now you get that moment of, oh my chona. But, you know, because I'm a pastor, yes. You know? Now you think like, God, but you know, I know who's to blame here. It's Estelle, his great R teacher here. Because she taught him that right from the word go. So he always prays like that, you know. So teachers, you are very important. And so, yeah, we form a little group, we pray, and now the faithless older people walk around and say, and you sort of in your head make plans as how you're going to buy another one or get the, you know, drive through and, oh, we have another one, and just get the whole situation. Eh? And so half an hour later, the kids go to swim. And so now everybody's walked in front. They've searched there and all that stuff. And my oldest daughter, she goes in. And my vrintivar, here we find the rod. But there's something weird about the whole experience in the sense of the line broke off, but then next to the rod, in the water, we find the sinker and the hook and all that stuff, but the fish is gone, but it's broken. So the fish was there and had to swim back. So I still try to figure out scientifically this doesn't work. So God didn't just bring the rod back, but the hook and the sinkers and all this stuff was right there. And I was thinking like, okay, Lord, what are you trying to teach me, the faithless one, the unbelieving believer? Because, you know, kids know that. Kids surrender because you told them, let's pray. If they're in trouble, pray. And then many times you know, I'm not going to tell that story. But in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, it says, for this, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ, who in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation. This is Jesus. And took upon himself the form of a bondservant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in the likeness of man, he humbled himself. You see, if there's any tension or tendency to go to pride, and pride just means you rely on your own self-righteousness. Anything remotely going to pride, you cannot know God. God has got no pride. God is self-sufficient. God cannot change. That's why we can worship God. But the moment when we worship anything of ourselves or people around us or the pastor in the church and we put them on a pedestal, do you know what's going to begin to happen? You're going to fall into pride, and that pastor is going to fall into pride. Because then you attain righteousness to yourself. And that's why to know God, humility, it's the only way. a brokenness, a surrender, a place of something inside of you that's going to cause almost a godly frustration. If you're a true Christian and you want to follow God, there's a certain frustration in your life that you need to deal with, and that is called a hunger. And that's the third thing. If you want to know God, Matthew 5 says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be full." It's almost a discontent with where you're at. But it's not a fear of failure. It's not a fear of rejection. It's not a motivation that I'm not good enough. It's, I want to know. I want to know Him. You know, that word for know, lots of us, especially when you do marriage prep, that word for know in the Old Testament is the word yada, and the Greek and the different languages have different names for that word know, but it is to personally to know somebody on a very intimate level. It's the same word that the Bible used for sexual intercourse. To know somebody not just in a knowledge or in a fleshly way, but in a much deeper way. That's why the world tries to break down and tries to make it as if we're just animals, as even sex is just something you do as a hobby. That's why many people, because they don't realize the power, the intimacy, the knowing, and on what a level you can know somebody. And that's why marriages are so important to God, because it's the only place where God's love can really be reflected. I said to the facilitators when we spoke that there's four types of love that the Bible refers to. The agape, the philia, which is a friendship. Agape is God's unconditional love. Sergio, which is a protective love. And then eros, which is a romantic love. And it's only in marriage that all four of those loves can manifest. Jesus' marriage to the church and the marriage between a husband and wife. And that's why the devil attacks it. And that's why the church must brace itself, and you must pray for your marriage, and pray for if you're young here, pray for the marriages in the church. Because the devil is working very hard to redefine marriage. He wants to break it down so that God's true heart cannot be revealed. We cannot know God if our society's family structures falls apart and if marriage is broken down. Because God wants to reflect something very, especially His protective nature, His Father's heart through marriages, through husband and wife coming together. And it's the same word God uses for knowing. It's the same word Paul uses here. I want to know Him. I want to know Him in a place where I feel completely vulnerable, but completely protected. Completely in a safe space. And that's why adultery will kill. And that's why, I remember there was a lady and her husband that were for 20 years married, and then the lady came, I don't know, it just comes to mind, but I'm going to be obedient now. The lady came and she said, "Do you know what? I want to divorce you," she said to the husband. And you know what she said? The main reason for 20 years was the fact that they slept together a week before they got married. And she says, from that moment, she did not trust him. From that moment, trust was broken. Why? Because there was a boundary crossed that only marriage can handle, only covenant in God. She said, for 20 years, I did not trust you. Now there's a place where you and I, what we see in the natural, there's a reflection of God's love, of His true nature through what we do. And that's why God says, I want to know Him. And the last one I want to share before we're going to partake the ushers, you guys can get the bread and wine along. John 14. It says, a little while longer and the world will see me no more, but you will see me because I live, you will live also. And that day you will know, again the same word, that I am in my Father and you in me and I in you. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Judas, not Iscariot, the other one, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. God says, in the context of obedience, our capacity begins to grow to know Him. Therefore, knowing in the biblical term is not just a knowing, an intellectual of reading your Bible. That's where it starts. But it's in revelation knowledge and then living an obedient lifestyle. And in this context, the Holy Spirit wants to help us because He says that, and Jesus says it, you will be known by me, but then He uses a word. He says, I will manifest myself to Him, and the Father and I, we will come to make our home with them. Sure. That's the greatest mystery that Ephesians 1, Paul talks about, is the mystery, Christ in us, the hope of glory. The fact that God would come to live inside of us, and that is what separates Christianity from any other religion. Even the Christian religion, any other religion is on what you do on the outside, getting peace from the outside, not, you know, appeasing the gods, not being afraid. You know, if you go to India, then everybody puts their stuff out every day because they just want to make the gods feel happy. Don't make the gods get angry at me. When you go to these big temples there in Myanmar and these places, everybody comes to bring their stuff because the more I'm a good person on the outside, the more I will receive a peace on the inside. It's only true Christianity that works the other way around, a knowing from the inside out. All the others are from the outside in. And that's why our performance or doing stuff, and that's why Paul says, I count all these things as rubbish because it's not the outside, it's what happens here. It's when the Holy Spirit comes to make home inside of me. The Holy Spirit comes to dwell, the indwelling Holy Spirit. And we can quench the Holy Spirit. We can grieve the Holy Spirit by doing sin or just ignoring the Holy Spirit. But there's a freedom because Jesus said, I'm going to manifest myself to you. I'm going to make myself known. And it's in such a greater level where God's manifestation comes. Yes, God is omnipresent. He's with us all the time. So you don't need to feel Him. But then there's the manifest presence of God where suddenly, like Moses comes down from the mountain and His face shines. Suddenly people say, there's something different about your family, about your home. And we're gonna end off this morning by asking God to come, and as we draw near to Him, as we come to surrender to Him, we're going to say, God, we want You to make Yourself known to us because we want to know You. We don't want to know about You. We don't want to just be people that go through the motions because it's nice to do things, that I might know Him. And if that is not your prayer for that you grow in that in the end of the year, do you know what? You, as a Christian, you cannot stand still. You are going to backslide. You're either going to go ahead, like Paul says, I press on. That means sometimes discipline, I need to count the cost. But I'm stretching myself out to know Christ, to be known by Him because I've been found by Him. He was never lost. I'm lost. Amen. So we're gonna do something a bit different this morning, and I want us to break up in groups of five. And of those five, or maybe not more than seven, but I want us to sit with people, especially people that we don't know. And then I want us, each one, but let's not make it more than five, otherwise we're going to be busy for a long time. And we only have like 10 minutes to do this. I want you to tell that person, what are you most attracted to Christ and to the Father? What aspect? Because there are many aspects of God. And next week we're going to talk a little about that when we're going to ask, how big is our God? Yeah? You can throw on that last slide just as we think of this, of the fact that God is omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. Even science cannot define God. Science is just an expression. You know, science actually comes from Christians. It's actually just a bit of expression of something of the heart of God. But to know a being that is all-powerful, all-knowing, everywhere, will break your and my mind if we try to grasp Him with our minds and not with the eyes of our understanding. So we're gonna share with each other, because what's going to start to happen when we start to share with each other, we start to realize that we've got different giftings, because all of us will relate to something of God's heart. Primarily, yes, the Father's heart, but there's something that God wants to reveal to us And you've been made in the image of God, and that's the value that God wants to release. When you and I start to know Him, we must also start to know each other. And that's why fellowship and community is so important in the church, and especially the local church, because in that there's an expression of who God also is, but it always only happens through relationship. And that's so beautiful about the testimony this morning. Hey, we were in trouble. Small group leader drives through. People pray. All the giftings. Everybody comes to bring the protective love of God into a situation. That's why church is there. This is just celebration every week of what God has done through the week. Amen. Yeah.